Okay, so this is reflecting what's in that chart on page 26. So you're going to get antiplatelet therapy in addition to aspirin to all patients. So the antiplatelet therapy are the PGY12 receptor inhibitors. So we're going to talk about them next. All patients should get aspirin in one of those P2Y12 receptor blockers. So those would be like clopidogrel, pasugrel, ticagrelor, and then cangrelor, all of those. So let's talk about platelet aggregation first. Did you all go over that in PEP-A-PHYS? Have you talked about that?
A long time ago.
I gave you this diagram because there are different source or different points at which these different antiplatelets will affect platelet aggregation. So let's just review that real quickly, platelet aggregation. So usually platelets, when they are in just circulating and just hanging out and doing their thing, they are going to look like this, kind of flat. Small shaped. Here's in comparison to a red blood cell and a white blood cell. Here's an that's an activated platelet. So when platelets, so platelets are always circulating. If you have some type of disruption or injury to the endothelium, then you have exposure of that in that endothelium of products or like collagen or other substances that normally aren't there. So when they are there, then the platelet has these receptors that bind the von Willebrand factor, which is one of the factors in the clotting cascade. And they then can adhere to that area. And then what they do is the platelet, so that's platelet adhesions, the first step. So next is activation and aggregation. So the platelets undergo a conformational change there's the release of ADP from the platelet, and it changes the shape of the platelets into these activated forms. So they form these pseudopods, and these pseudopods then can form bridges with fibrinogen to adhere to each other. So they become more sticky, would be a way to think about it. They also activate a lot of receptors, which we take advantage of and have drugs that will sit up and antagonize them. And they secrete chemical messengers like serotonin and ADP and thromboxane. Some of those help recruit. So they send messages to other platelets in the area and say, come and join us. And that's what then starts to make this white clot or this real thick clot before fibrin gets involved. So platelets will connect to one another through these. So here's those GP2B3A receptors will bind fibrinogen, and that will be one way that they can form these links and these bridges. And we have drugs that will work against those. Then there's secretion. So these platelets have lots of granules in them, and they contain lots of factors that they release. And then they have some procoagulant activities. So they can then bring in the coagulation or activate the coagulation cascade in order to produce fibrin, which will eventually lay down a very stable clot. So eventually the body wants to get to this, to where it's got platelets, red blood cells, there'll be white blood cells in there as well, and there will be fibrin lacing all over it to hold it down in place. So there's two receptors. There's this P2Y1 and this P2Y12. And the antiplatelets that we're looking at are going to sit on that on this receptor and prevent those platelets from sticking together. So if you look at the top of page 11, we'll talk about each individual. These, because this is the bulk of a lot of what you would do in terms of antiplatelets would be these agents. Clopidogrel's been around. It's really a second generation. There was another one on the market before this called triclopidine, but it had too many side effects, and so it was removed from the market. So clopidogrel, or Plavix, is one of the oldest in this field, and it is an ADP receptor inhibitor. So it sits on that receptor and prevents the release of ADP. So ADP is one of the big messengers that that platelets use to communicate to each other and to start that aggregation sequence. Clopidogrel and pasitegrel are both prodrugs. So what do you remember about prodrugs? So do they have activity themselves? No, they don't. Sometimes it's to our advantage because we can get around things that the body likes to do in order to get a drug to the place where we want it to exert its effect. So this, I put this in here just to give you kind of a visual on these different agents because clopidogrel, pasitegrel, active agent, or prodrugs. Clopidogrel actually has to go through two sequential transformations before it becomes a final drug. So here you have these lines to denote irreversible binding, non-competitive reversible binding, and competitive reversible binding. So all of these drugs have slightly different way of interacting with that receptor. Then it gives you a key for the prodrugs, inactive metabolites, intermediate metabolites, and active metabolites. So clopidogrel has to undergo two transformations to get to the final active product, and then it interacts with that P2Y12 receptor. Pasitegrel is also undergoes transformation by the liver. It's also a prodrug. It only has one step, also acts at the same site. Ticagrelor and canagrelor are drugs that do not have to be transformed, so they're quicker in action, but they also interact with that same receptor. One of the problems with clopidogrel, even though it's generic, it's cheaper, it's well known, it's been around a long time, but some of the problems in dealing with it is that it also has a lot of drug interactions. So I put down two there, and these are significant: the proton pump inhibitors and the statins. So the proton pump inhibitors will slow down that transformation. So you don't want to use those two drugs together. For the under the dose, I haven't decided which. Some of these I want you to know doses, most of them I will not. I haven't decided about this one yet because it's so commonly used. But what I would like you to remember is that it requires a loading dose. And most of these do. And they use a loading dose in order to get platelet inactivation quicker. And then you put them on, clopidogrel only has a one dose, 75 milligrams daily thereafter. So the advantage of clopidogrel when it came out is that it didn't cause as much bleeding as aspirin did. So that was a good thing. But it also causes, but all of these drugs, if you affect a clot, you are going to affect bleeding. So all of these drugs we're going to talk about today can increase bleeding. This one also has a neutropenic effect. So it's the drug of choice if an antiplatelet is indicated and a fibrinolytic is going to be given in a patient with a STEMI. So we don't use clopidogrel as much. A lot of people prefer the ticagrelor, and so it gets used a little bit more often. So if you've got high bleed risk folks, then clopidogrel is a preferred because of the decreased amount. Pasigrul, its advantage is that its platelet aggregation inhibition is much more potent. It's a much more potent drug than clopidogrel. It's also very rapid in its onset, onsets within an hour, and it doesn't have as many drug interactions as clopidogrel. The problem with it is that it has some problems with in older folks and in skinnier folks. So you can see that the dose is reduced under the second bullet. So dose, it also requires a loading dose and then a daily dose. Dose is reduced in those under 60 kilos and in those over 75. If you look on the next page, contraindications. If you're over 75 and you don't have a high-risk stent, then it's contraindicated prior stroke or TIA, active or suspected bleeding. One thing I skipped over, didn't mean to do that. Look back on page 9. Did he talk about dual antiplatelet therapy? Okay, look on page 9 at the top. So whenever you use aspirin in combination with an antiplatelet, we call that dual antiplatelet therapy. So it's very effective. It has been shown to reduce cardiovascular events, MI, stroke. So patients are often going to be kept on that dual therapy for at least 12 months. And then the antiplatelet usually goes off and they'll continue on the aspirin. So that's an important concept to remember, is dual action or dual antiplatelet activity. Depending on the stent and the type of stent, there will be protocols for how long you will leave them on antiplatelets. So I wanted to point that out. So we're going to leave them on that for a length of time. So you can imagine bleeding risk is quite high when you've got those two agents on board all the time. So what else might they complain about? Easy bruising. Their arms will just be beat up. You know, they'll tell you, I just knocked my arm against the door and I got this bruise, and that's true. Okay. So, and look down under adverse effects. So bleeding, you can say with all of them. The other that's different with Pasigrul is that TTP. So thrombotic thrombocytopenic. There's a black box warning. So this is why this drug is not used as often, is because of the side effect profile. So they can form little blood clots in their vessels, and they can consume their platelets. So they tend to have a very low platelet count, so they tend to bleed more easily as well. So to Cragrelor, Brilinta. You know, the people who determine those names are the marketers, and they are the people who, like, what will make it sell. So wouldn't you want to be on something called Brilinta? To me, it's more like something that would make you smarter, but that's the name they chose. So Brilinta. So this one tends to be a more favorite, and you'll see it in the chart. More commonly, it's the first one recommended of the antiplatelets. Also requires a loading dose. Can be given then daily. This one is a twice daily. Note the about aspirin. So you have to use it with a low dose of aspirin. So low dose is usually that 81 milligrams a day. Higher doses tend to decrease the effectiveness of the Tegrelor. Under kinetics, it's very rapid. That's again why people like it. It doesn't have to be transformed, so that's part of its speed. It's also quicker in offset than Pasigrul. So Pasigrul has a longer duration of action, has a longer half-life, so it takes longer for the patient to recover once you take them off of it. Tegrelor is shorter, so it's quick on, quick off. That's good. So you can get the work done and then get out of there. It is a little bit different in that it will inhibit CY3A4, so it can increase drugs, but some of the stronger inhibitors, the CYP3A4 inhibitors, will inhibit ticagrelor's metabolism, and so those levels will go up. So what I keep in mind is that it interacts with 3A4. So look it up, because that then you got a whole host of drugs in that. That's got hundreds of drugs in that category. Questions?
I have one.
Yeah.
Do they have to be on aspirin with this?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, they should be on a low-dose aspirin with it, yeah. If you look at discontinuation times before they have like a procedure, it helps you to know in terms of duration of effect on platelets. So that one probably has one of the shortest. It has an unusual, it has all the other side effects, the bleeding that we talked about, but it has an unusual side effect about dyspnea. Usually occurs very early on. It can be transient, it can be persistent. Usually it goes away when you take them off the drug, and that doesn't have anything to do with their pulmonary or cardiac status or a change in it. So it's just one of those odd side effects. Cangrelor, it is has a very narrow action. It's IV, the others are all oral. And it has it's approved as an adjunct therapy when you're undergoing a stent placement. It's in people who have not been treated with another platelet inhibitor and are not receiving the glycoprotein 2B3A inhibitors. It's extremely quick, so you can see why they like it around the time of a procedure. Its action is 2 minutes on, and then duration of action is also really short. Oh yeah, platelet function returns to normal within 2 hours or an hour after you are done with the procedure. So 2 minute onset, platelets are back to normal within 1 hour, as opposed to days with the oral agents. Okay. Bleeding common. Page 14, that top goes with the, is kind of the descriptor of the previous picture. I'll hold off on that picture on the back and pick it up in a minute. Okay, questions about the antiplatelets? Look over on page 26. Let's just review where they fit. Top of page 26, so this is acute management, unstable angina, non-stenting. So after aspirin, it says give all patients an antiplatelet. See that at the very top? So Tagrelor is usually the one they're going to recommend. So that's for people. So you also, your other decision point is whether you're going to do an invasive procedure or not. So you see the difference there. In terms of, so Tagrelor, if you're going to not do an intervention, if you're going to do an intervention, then they also recommend that one, but they then give you the, you can use the other ones as well. Pessagrel and Clopidogrel. Okay, so go back and look at the anticoagulants. So go back in your handout. Okay, so anticoagulants. So have you talked about the clotting cascade? Is it? Yeah, okay. Good. So you have, and this is in your handout as well, so constantly circulating in your bloodstream is you have these inactivated clotting factors. Where are they made? The liver makes a lot of them. So the liver puts out these inactivated proteins, does it with a lot of different things, but for this purpose, these clotting factors. So they're always present. So if some injury happens in your vascular system, they're right there. Platelets are right there. So you've got all the substances there that you need to stop that bleeding. So you've got the platelet side, and you've got these coagulation factors that can also help stop bleeding. So they act differently. You talked about intrinsic and extrinsic pathway. Okay. So intrinsic pathway, most of those are liver-produced factors. And they can be internal, and the external, like the trauma they show here, tissue factors that can set them off or start that cascade. Talked about the common, so both of those pathways lead to that common pathway, which is factor 10 to 10A. And then 10A converts prothrombin to thrombin. So what is thrombin's role? What's its job? It activates fibrinogen to fibrin, and then fibrin is what holds a clot together. Okay. So once you have a clot that has formed, and you have used medications or procedure to remove that clot, one of the things you want to do is keep it from reoccluding. So using an anticoagulant will help do that. So most of the time people are going to be on an anticoagulant as well. Here's another picture that I thought was good because thrombin becomes important with some of these drugs we're talking about. So you've got the clotting cascade coming down and thrombin converting that fibrinogen into a fibrin. And then we also have thrombin being converted by protein C and also protein S, and they help to inactivate and stop clot, they terminate a clot. These will become real important when we talk about clotting disorders, because deficiencies in protein C and protein S can lead to, you can't terminate a clot. You produce lots of clots all the time. Okay, so key points. Let's go over the key points. So anticoagulants include the IV, the heparins, low molecular weight. So we have unfractionated heparin, low molecular weight heparin, and the direct thrombin inhibitors, which is bivalirudin. Begin anticoagulant therapy for all patients with a non-stimmy who don't have a contraindication. You can use enoxaparin or fondaparinux, but unfractionated heparin is often preferred because it's quicker, its action, its duration of action is shorter, so you can terminate the action more quickly. Note that about the fondaparinux is that you don't want to use it alone in STEMIs or patients undergoing PCI. You want to give it with another anticoagulant. Usually given for 48 hours and discontinued for discharge. So it's more in the acute situation, then we'll stabilize them with other medications going out the door, because these are all going to be given by injection. Okay, so let's look at unfractionated heparin. So unfractionated heparin, if you're looking at your clotting cascade, it inactivates 2A and 10A. So that's really important, that 10A, because of its being in the common pathway. And it prevents the conversion of fibrinogen to fibrin and clot formation. So if you look at this one, this is the unfractionated heparin. Here's thrombin, here's antithrombin. So these cause a conformational change in antithrombin so that thrombin and antithrombin really can't fit together and then it work. And it also works on 10A and antithrombin, so it inhibits factor of the 10A, so it terminates activity higher up in the cascade. So heparin is given by IV. It's weight-based. It does have a max dose, so it usually doesn't exceed the 5,000 units. And then you put them on a constant infusion. Did you talk about an activated partial thromboplastic line, a PTT? Mm-hmm. You all talked about that, okay. So tell me what you know about it. Just in general.
Extrinsic.
Yeah, it's more, heparin works more on the extrinsic pathway as well, other factors it affects. So it measures more the activity in the extrinsic pathway. So how do you use it? I hear coagulopathies, what?
Yeah, to identify them and what factor they originate from.
I guess you could. Usually we use it more to monitor the effect of the anticoagulant. We only use it with heparin. We use an INR when we use warfarin. So other anticoagulants, we use different monitors. So what we're doing is when we give somebody an anticoagulant, we're trying to lengthen out the time from an insult to or a bleeding to a clot. Okay. So you all have lengths of time. You know, if you prick your finger, how long does it take for it to clot off and no longer bleed? Okay, so that's normal. If we give you an anticoagulant like warfarin or heparin, then the length of when you poke your finger and it bleeds, that time will lengthen. Okay. So we can say that the time without being on an anticoagulant is from here to here, and then we can compare what it is when we put you on that anticoagulant from here to here. Okay. So we want to lengthen out that time from bleeding to clot. Okay. So that's what that test is doing. It is measuring that time. So we're going to lengthen it out because then we lengthen the time it takes for the body to clot. So it becomes a goal. So here you want your partial thromboplastin time 1.5 to 2 times baseline. So it's giving you a range of about 50 to 70. Okay. So we will keep adjusting that heparin dose until we hit that PTT. One good thing to remember about heparin is that it's not affected by your renal function. So that's good. The downside of heparin is that it can produce a heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. It's called HIT. If you develop it, then it's an immune-mediated destruction of the platelets. We'll talk more about that when we do anticoagulants. And then osteoporosis, if people have to be on it long term, that's unusual nowadays because we have other products that we can move them to. So we would monitor their PTT, their hemoglobin, their hematocrit in case they are bleeding, and in their platelet counts. Okay. So go on over to page 17 at the bottom of there. So probably 20 years ago, to try to improve on heparin and the problems that we have with it, they developed these products called low molecular weight heparins. If you kind of look back at 116, you see it has a similar effect that heparin does, but it's not quite as potent. They're less potent, but we get around some of the other problems. You don't see HIT with the low molecular weight heparins. They're longer in action, and we can give them subcutaneous. We don't have to give them IV. And they tend to have less bleeding problems. So there's a lot of advantages to using them. There are several in this category. Enoxaparin is probably the most commonly one used. Lovenox is the brand name, so enoxaparin. It's dosed on a milligram per kilo basis, but you have to take into account the renal function. So you've got to know their serum creatinine and determine a creatinine clearance before you give it. You can still give it to people who are have renal insufficiency, but you decrease the number of times a day that you give it. So most people get 2 injections a day, and those with renal insufficiency get 1. Questions about that one? Then Fondaparinux or Arixtra is a factor 10A inhibitor, so it's different. It is specific to just 10A. That's why it doesn't have as wide of use as the other two, because it doesn't hit as many parts of the cascade. Can't use it in renal insufficiency. It's an alternative, less bleeding. So if you have someone who's high risk, you can use it. It just doesn't have the all-around same effect that you'll get with the other two. The last one is Valrudin, Angiomax. It is a direct thrombin inhibitor. It's probably one of the last of the group that you would use. It's reversible. If you've got somebody who has had a heparin-induced thrombocytopenia, you could use it in that case. It's cleared by the kidney, so you have to watch renal function when you use it as well. So it's an option. It's an alternative. Has a different mechanism of action. Okay, so let's go back to page 26 again. So you'll see that it divides under give anticoagulant to all patients. So you're going to give everybody an aspirin, everybody an antiplatelet, everybody anticoagulant. So you can see bleed risk, bleed risk, bleed risk. So you see how bleeding becomes a significant problem that must be monitored and addressed if it occurs. So they divide that anticoagulant therapy into those who are undergoing an urgent catheterization or those receiving a non-invasive approach. So for those undergoing a cath, they prefer the heparin because of its duration of action is lower. And if they're undergoing a non-invasive approach, then you can use enoxaparin or fondaparinux. I'm going to focus much more on the drug knowledge part for this section. I'm going to expect that on Scott's stuff, his will focus much more on where you give it and when you give it. Now, I might say some general, big picture for those drugs, but mine is much going to be on drug information part. Okay? All right. Okay, the STEMIs. So I created a flow sheet for you. Up to date, really didn't have one that I liked. So that's there for you to see flow. So you look at your decision points. If you see at the top, you're going to give them the very same thing. So it's oxygen, it's nitroglycerin, it's beta blockers, it's aspirin, morphine if needed, or an antiplatelet. And then it comes down to how long have they had symptoms? Greater than 12 hours, less than 12 hours. It's also going to come down to is can you get them into an invasive procedure quickly? So if you can't, then you're going to use a fibrinolytic. If you can, you're going to go with a PCI. That would be preferred. But if that's delayed, then you can use a fibrinolytic. Did you go over STEMIs? Okay. All right. So top of next page, 20. So goal, restore coronary blood flow, because these people have had an occlusive thrombus. So they are at great risk of ischemic changes in death. He talked about risk stratifications. He talked about TIMI, and they use HART. There's another one called GRACE. So they use that to determine, pathways. What kind of things are you going to do, an invasive or non-invasive, or what are medical treatment? How are you going to treat them? So for the fibrinolytics are only used in STEMIs. We don't use them in non-STEMIs or unstable angina. So what it does is fibrinolytics are called clot busters. So I think that's very descriptive of what they do. They are going to enhance the body's ability to break down a clot quickly. They don't work so well in the non-stimmies because their clots don't tend to be fibrin-rich. So these drugs target fibrin, or they're best in, actually they target plasminogen, but they are going to help break down those fibrin products. Okay, so if you look on the top of page 21, you'll see that all these drugs help to enhance the conversion of plasminogen to plasmin. There's three on the market, and they're all very different in how they are made or produced. So Adelplase, Reteplase, and Tenecteplase are the three. The last one is the one that is preferred. So let's look at it first. It's much more fibrin specific, and it has a very high resistance to being terminated by the enzymes that are present there. It has a lower bleeding rate, longer half-life, easier to use. You give an injection, you're done. With the others, you have to do a drip. It is based on weight, and the total dose does not exceed 50. Adelplase has been around a long time. It was probably the second one that came out. Streptokinase and urokinase were the first two. Streptokinase is no longer available in the United States, so this one was kind of a second generation. It has a very short half-life. You need to use heparin when you use it. So it's just a little bit harder to use. I think probably ease of use and cost are probably going to be the two. Anybody working? You work, JC. Mm-hmm. Do you all keep this in the...
I was actually going to ask that because I remember one time specifically we had a person come in with the stroke and they used the one dose we had of a clotbuster and it was like some ungodly amount of money that the hospital has to pay to keep it on hand. Because it's, I mean, we very rarely see anything that's in the middle of nowhere.
So they had a thrombogenic stroke?
And they used I don't remember the details. I just remember them saying TPA. And because when I came here, I was like, well, that sounds familiar. That's probably what they use. But I was like, what do we do if we use it all? They don't have it anymore.
Yeah.
But they very rarely kept it on hand. If they did, it was one dose.
Okay, must have been that one then. Okay, so thrombolytics should be administered within 30 minutes of arrival to the hospital. Not recommended the UA or STEMI. We talked about that. Class effect is bleeding, injection site reaction, fibrinolysis or PCI. PCI is preferred if you can get them in, but fibrinolysis can be used, again, like if you can't get them into the cath lab or have that available. The contraindications to use are on page 22. So they make sense. If they have had a recent stroke and it was a hemorrhagic stroke, you're not going to use it. If they've got a neoplasm in their brain, if they have suspected aortic dissection, active bleeding, a bleeding diathesis, which means they're bleeding profusely from some site, or if they've had a closed head or facial trauma within the last 3 months. I mean, you could probably guess those because the risk of bleeding goes up so high. So any, let's see. So if you look on page 27, that will give you the acute management of STEMI. Talks about selecting a reperfusion strategy. That's where that risk estimator comes in handy. And then treating with fibrinolysis if PCI is not available. Go back to page 22 again. There's one other set of drugs that I want to show you. They're not used as often. They're more specialized. This is the glycoprotein 2B3A. So I want to go back to this picture and show you what they are. These agents are these the glycoprotein 2B and 3A are, they're like bridges. They are on those pseudopods, and they bind fibrinogen. And they are the structures that help hold that those platelets together when they aggregate. So these drugs, these blockers, block the ability of those receptors to bind fibrinogen. These receptors are also activated. I don't know that they're always a bit, on top of the cell surface, but when you have that activation of platelets and that change in shape, these receptors are activated during that process. So if you look at the second bullet, subgroups of patients with STEMI who may benefit from IV GP2B3A inhibitors include those receiving heparin without an antiplatelet and those who have found to have no reflow or large thrombus burden. So you've done you may have done an initial something and there's no flow through that vessel. Or the thrombus is very large. So these are not widely used products. There's three of them that are on the market. There's Riopro, and then the other one, Integrilin and Aggrastat. I just gave you the Riopro's kind of their, just as a reference. I'm not really going to ask you much about these. I want you to know what category they fit into and what their mechanism of action is. I think you will not see them very often, unless you're in a big area where you're going to see a lot of heart attacks coming. On the next page, there is a chart there that I created. It is for the post-coronary syndrome treatments. The only thing that we didn't discuss and really doesn't come up in the protocols are ACE inhibitors. But they are, they have a place in that they are have very good cardiac effects that can help in the post-MI patient. So I included them there, but we'll cover them again when we get into heart failure. The next page is that algorithm, and the last three pages are those charts. Questions about those? Yeah, Jason.
For the Lovenox, is there a, I know it says to reduce by 50% if your acne clearance is less than 30, but is there like a lower limit on that? Like, don't you think it's lower than something?
No, we use it. I don't think so. I'll look, but I don't think there is. It may be less than like 10 or 20. I'll look that up. Okay, I hope the pictures help. I would appreciate it. Okay, so do these types of handouts help? Is there something else that would help differently?
Can you ask the other professors?
Okay, I would, if you have something in particular, some have told me and I've tried to adjust them, so I'm happy to hear from you if you feel like there's something that would help. Was there anything said today that conflicted with Scott Inwitz's lecture? Okay, it's a hard one, but I think if you will put them in categories, I think it helps a lot. And what it gets down to now, it gets real specific. If they come in with this type of heart attack, you're going to do this. If you're going to do a procedure, you're going to do this. So how those drugs lay down depend on the presentation of the patient and what you're going to do for them. Okay, I hope you have a wonderful weekend, and I will see you the middle of the week, I think, for...